Without further ado, I'd like to spend some time introducing our speaker for the day, Dr. Bill Weiss. He's a technically retired professor of dairy cattle nutrition in the Department of Animal Sciences at The Ohio State University. Earned his undergraduate and master's degrees from Purdue University, followed by his PhD from The Ohio State University. Shortly after, Dr. Weiss joined the faculty at The Ohio State University, where he pursued a joint appointment in research, extension, and teaching. Impressively, Dr. Weiss has authorized over 125 journal articles. Very, very impressive, an expansive career. With 350 popular press articles and participated as a guest lecturer in 40 states, 29 countries, sharing his knowledge on dairy cattle nutrition and management. Most recently, Dr. Weiss served as vice chair and looking at the new NRC Dairy Requirement Committee. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce him here today to start his presentation for you all. Thank you very much.
Okay. I'm assuming you can see my screen. Oh, now I can. Okay. Now I'm assuming you can see my screen. Okay.
Yes, we can.
Okay. Thank you. I didn't want to talk to nobody for a while. But thank you for that introduction. It's a pleasure to be here. And good morning from a sunny Cincinnati, Ohio. I'd like to start off first acknowledging my co-author on this talk, Rich Erdman. He and I together worked extensively on the mineral section of the new, it's now called NASEM, but I'm going to keep referring it to the new NRC. Same basic organization, just a different name. When we took the charge of evaluating the mineral requirements or the vitamin requirements, first thing we did was just ask, do we think they need to be updated? Because if there was no new data or we think the old system worked, we didn't revise it. But when we decided, yeah, this mineral needed to be looked at closer, we looked at equations to estimate requirements, but we also spent a lot of time on the absorption side of the equation. And you're going to see a lot of those that have changed, which we think makes it more accurate. And we also introduced some new concepts here. We still have the term requirement, which I'm going to define in a minute. We also use the term adequate intake to describe some minerals and vitamins. And then we also use the term response for some minerals and vitamins. A requirement, if we say the requirement for calcium, what it means is we have confidence in the data that we have enough information to actually call this a requirement. And it's important to note that this is the average requirement for a specific population of cows. If you, for example, put in a 650 kilogram cow producing 40 kilograms of milk, what's going to come up is the average calcium requirement for that type of cow. It's an average. And as we all know, averages meet half the population, 50%. In the U.S., and this may be other countries as well, but in the U.S., for the human, what we call the recommended daily allowance, or sometimes just daily allowance, it's the average requirement, but then they add two standard deviations. For when they do minerals and vitamins. And the theory is that if you add two standard deviations, you are going to actually provide enough mineral and vitamin for 98% of the population, or essentially you meet the requirements for all the people in that population. However, for most minerals and vitamins, this is a very good theoretical approach, but they don't know the standard deviation for these requirements. So what they did in the human system is they used the variance measured for energy metabolism in humans, and the CV for energy metabolism is about 20%. So basically in the human U.S. system, it's the average requirement times 1.2 is the daily allowance. So again, with that system, you feed essentially the whole population. The NRC, however, our duty, and we were told very clearly, you come up with requirements or adequate intakes. For the average population, we do not add this safety factor. So if you were formulating, you'd start with the requirements, but then you still should add a safety factor, because again, the requirements, even if it's perfect, is only going to meet the needs for 50% of the population. And from other work we've done, for most minerals and vitamins, this 20% extra actually is probably a very good number. It's a good safety factor. But again, the data I'm going to talk about is the requirement users have to apply safety factors. For some minerals and vitamins that are required, rather than calling them a requirement, we call them an adequate intake. And this just has to do with the confidence we have in the data. If we have a lot of data, a good confidence, we say this is the requirement. If data is limited, we say this is the adequate intake or recommended adequate intake. And all that means is you have to feed it. So we're saying if your diet has this much of mineral X, the cows will probably be okay. It's just a level of confidence. It doesn't mean you don't need to meet that adequate intake. It's just the level of confidence. Another term you're going to see for some minerals and vitamins is response or response function. And this is for some of these minerals and vitamins that we say that this is the response to are required. We know they're required. We just don't know how much is required. So we talk about if you feed or supplement this much of a certain mineral or vitamin, you might get a response, a milk production or a health response. Over here is a response surface, and that's really what we need to generate for all these nutrients. This has nothing to do with minerals and vitamins, but it just is milk fat response to starch and alfalfa. And it shows that cows respond, but that doesn't mean starch is required, and it doesn't mean alfalfa is required. It just means if you feed this, you might get a response. And for the minerals and vitamins where we talk about responses, and we give no requirement for these, but chromium, we don't know how much they need. We know it's required. We don't know how much, but we do talk about if you feed this, you're going to get, or you may get a response. Same for choline, biotin, DCAD, so forth. Okay, so let's get back to the requirements. We used for almost all minerals the factorial approach. This got moved a little bit, but the maintenance is endogenous fecal and endogenous urine. That's the maintenance requirement. For most minerals and vitamins, urine is not a major a requirement. For a lot of it's zero, but endogenous fecal is big. The mineral in the milk, the mineral in growth of body tissue, new body tissue, and then the mineral retained in the fetus and the conceptus. So you add these up, that's the total absorbed requirement. You divide by an absorption coefficient to get dietary requirement. This is the same model they used in 2001. The equations may differ, but it's the same model. Key points here, this model assumes cows are healthy. If not, we don't know how that affects mineral and vitamin requirements. We also assume cows are in adequate status, because all this does, if you meet this requirement every day, you're just replacing what is lost. The body stores will not increase using this model. So if cows are deficient or marginal in something, you need to feed some extra to get body stores where they should be. I put stars, again, this star should be over here by endogenous fecal, and a star by absorption coefficient, because these two numbers first are correlated, which I'm going to talk about, and they also, especially for the trace minerals, they have huge effects on dietary requirements, just huge effects. And I'm going to spend some time on those. Measuring absorption coefficient is more than just what goes in one end of the cow and what comes out the other. That is not the absorption coefficient. Unfortunately, that's easy to measure, but it is not. And if you use that number, and that's called the apparent absorption, you will get bad information. Your requirements will not be correct. Absorption coefficient is, apparent absorption is just intake minus fecal losses. That's apparent absorption. But what we need is the dietary unabsorbed mineral. Not total fecal mineral, but the amount of mineral that was not absorbed. Fecal mineral has this, and this is the biggest fraction usually, But there's also endogenous mineral, endogenous fecal mineral. This mineral was absorbed and then it's re-secreted into the gut, either as slough cells or secretions, but it was absorbed. And for some minerals, we have an additional complication in that feces are used for homeostatic control or excretion. If a cow absorbs too much zinc is a good example. If a cow absorbs too much zinc, some of that zinc is retained in an enterocyte to control and protect the cow from excess zinc. When that cell is sloughed, it goes into the feces. This is a constant based on dry matter intake. This is not constant. If you feed just the right amount of mineral, this will be close to zero. If you really overfeed mineral, this could be high. So that's an issue with this system, is that it's not as straightforward as we would like. But the AC, again, is just intake minus feces, but you from the fecal excretion, you subtract metabolic fecal and this homeostatic excretion. Just as an example, I'm using zinc, and these numbers are reasonable. They vary, but these are reasonable. So if a cow eats 1,500 milligrams of zinc, we expect fecal excretion to be around 1,340. Of that, 1,200 milligrams were unabsorbed. The cow ate it and it goes right out in feces. About 125 milligrams would be endogenous fecal. And in this example, I said homeostatic is 15. Apparent absorption, again, is just this minus this, intake minus fecal. That gives you an 11% or a 0.11 AC. The correct AC is you correct for endogenous fecal and homeostatic excretion, and you get an AC of 20%, 0.2. If you use this number, which again is easy to measure, you would basically, in this example, overfeed zinc by almost a factor of two. So we cannot use apparent absorption. We have to figure out a way to get true absorption coefficients. But these are really hard to measure. The old way is we would feed radioactive isotopes of these minerals, and then we could separate endogenous from a dietary. Most of this data is 50, 60 years old, because 50 and 60 years ago, they could feed radioactive isotopes to cows relatively easily. We can't do that now. So we can still use stable isotopes, and that's how they get these numbers for rats and humans. But it's very expensive, and with cows, because they eat so much, it will be even more expensive. But we clearly need this data. If we want to advance mineral nutrition, we need somebody to spend some money on getting better absorption coefficients, and it's going to be expensive. Another problem, which actually helps a bit, this problem actually is not a real problem, it helps. And that is endogenous fecal and AC are often, for a lot of these minerals, correlated. And so if we overestimate the endogenous fecal requirement, that also usually means the AC, absorption coefficient, is inflated. So part of this error will cancel out. Not the whole thing. It still will be wrong, but some of this error, if we're wrong on one, very often we're wrong on the other, and they go in the direction that some of that error is reduced. For the electrolytes, we have very good absorption data because we can use a statistical technique. It's developed by a statistician probably 40 or 50 years ago named Curly Lucas. And it's basically we regress diet mineral. In this example, it's potassium against the concentration of absorbed potassium. And if this approach works, you get a nice, well-fitting line. The slope, and I see I made a mistake here, the slope is 1.02. So this 1.02 is actually the slope. Sorry about this. I thought I fixed this. The slope, which is 1.02, is the absorption coefficient. So this is saying potassium is essentially 100% available. The intercept, which is minus 2.5, is the endogenous fraction. So this would say there's 2.5 grams per kilogram intake endogenous fecal potassium, it has an absorption coefficient of 100%. This approach works great for electrolytes. It can also be used for magnesium with some caveats. So we have better, much better data for absorption coefficients for magnesium and the electrolytes than for a lot of other minerals. Last thing before we get into the real numbers is you will often see for especially trace minerals, but for macro minerals as well, is relative availability. And this is, I'm going to use copper as an example here. The standards for trace minerals we use are the sulfates. So you'd feed copper sulfate to one set of animals and the test mineral, whatever it is, to the other set. Make sure the amount of supplemental mineral in the diets are the same. Measure something. For copper, it's usually liver. And then you take the ratio. And that ratio is the relative availability. And then, so to get the availability of source X, you would take the relative availability times the AC of copper sulfate, and that would give you the AC for source X. Some caveats. One, this is diet and situation specific, and I'll show some data in just a second. Another problem is it's relative. It's not the real number. It's a relative number. And perhaps the biggest problem is that, or a big problem, if the reference value, and in this example, copper sulfate, if the AC for copper sulfate is wrong, everything that you're using relative to copper sulfate also is wrong. Here's just an example for copper with this relative availability. I'm looking at tribasic copper here, or Jerry Spears' work. In a diet, this is with beef heifers or beef steers, I can't remember, but beef animals with antagonist, molybdenum and sulfur. If we look just at the orange bar here, this is liver copper. Tribasic copper under these conditions was essentially twice as available as copper sulfate. Under this condition, where the cows are deficient, they had the same bioavailability. So it is situation specific. But let's take this example here where tribasic is twice as available as copper sulfate. How do you get an AC then for tribasic copper? Well, under normal conditions, the copper and copper sulfate is about 5% available, and that's a pretty good number. But these are not normal conditions. But if you assume normal, if the AC of copper sulfate is 5%, it's twice as good. You'd give tribasic copper chloride 10% availability. But we know this is not a normal condition. This is an antagonized condition. And we'd really expect, copper sulfate to have about a 3.5% absorption coefficient, not 5. So you have to come up with what you think this is, and then I'd multiply by 2. So in this example, tribasic copper, would it be 7% available? Copper sulfate would be 3.5%. But you have to know what the reference is. Okay, now we'll get into what's new. With calcium, one of the big changes is the absorption coefficient. And if you look in this table, the first 4 lines are calcium supplements. The 2001 or 21 numbers are all substantially lower than what's in the 2001. The problem with 2001 is they used calcium chloride as the reference, and they said it had an absorption coefficient of 95%. That was based on calf data, and calves are very, very good at absorbing calcium. When you dig through and find the absorption measured absorption coefficient for calcium chloride with ruminants, and a calf is not really a ruminant yet, the value is only 0.6 instead of 0.95. So when you use this as the reference, here you can see we use 60% as the reference for calcium chloride, then all these other numbers go down because these were based on the assumption that calcium chloride was 95% available. For the basal feeds, the calcium chloride was not the reference. They actually dug through and dug up literature on this. We dug up some more literature, and so these changed a little bit. Basil is a little bit higher for the forages than in 2001. The concentrates were about the same. So on an average diet or an average North American diet with with the typical forages we have and the supplementation rates we have, absorption coefficient of calcium would have gone down from about 53% down to 45%. So there was significant changes in calcium ACs. On requirements, in 2001, the maintenance requirement for calcium, and these are absorbed, not diet, these are absorbed, it was a function of body weight. An endogenous fecal mineral should be a function of intake, not body weight. That's biologically incorrect. But you'll notice that for a dry cow, its coefficient here is half, essentially half what it is for lactating. So indirectly, they're adjusting for intake because a lactating cow is going to eat twice as much or more. Milk was given these numbers for Holsteins and Jerseys. We had enough data to put this as a function of intake, which again is biologically correct. But you also notice the milk levels dropped substantially. And this for what happened for a lot of minerals, which really surprised us. We didn't think the lactation requirement would change very much. Because it's easy to sample milk, easy to measure these minerals. But you'll see for a lot of minerals, milk concentrations are substantially different than they were in 2001. So basically, when we look at these in numbers, maintenance requirements for a dry cow hardly changed. Very different equation, but didn't hardly change. Maintenance for a lactating cow hardly changed. Milk goes down because the amount of calcium is lower in milk based on newer data than in 2001. So the net result is about a 9% reduction in absorbed requirement. And again, this is absorbed, not diet. To get diet, you have to divide by the AC, which was also modified. So you'll see very small increases in dietary calcium requirements, 4 or 5%. So basically, we think biologically these new equations are better, but at the end of the day, the requirements did not change very much. Same for phosphorus. We made some adjustments that we think are biologically more correct, but they're very minor and the absorbed requirements hardly changed at all. Supplement ACs didn't change. For feeds, we introduced a concept of partitioning phosphorus into inorganic and organic. Inorganic phosphorus is more available than organic. So if you measure these things, and these are assays that commercial labs could do, you can come up with a calculated AC for feeds, soybean meal, alfalfa, etc. But on average, it's going to be about the same as it was in 2001. So really very little difference, but this adjustment here should allow us to fine-tune diets a little better and reduce excess phosphorus. Magnesium changed a lot. Maintenance in 2001, again, was a function of body weight, which is incorrect. We had a lot more data for magnesium, so I have a lot more confidence in this data. The endogenous fecal is a function of intake. There is a small endogenous urinary requirement that was a function of body weight. So what you'll see in 2000, the requirement was about 2 grams for a 700 kilogram cow. In 2021, for a dry cow eating 12 kilograms, it's going to be double that. And for a lactating cow eating 25 kilograms, it's going to be essentially 3 times. So maintenance increased by a factor of 3. Milk, however, went down again. In 2001, if you read the text, they said milk has 0.15 grams magnesium per kilogram. And they chose this number because it was the highest value they could find in the literature. And I think they were worried that the requirements are going to come out too low. So they're kind of stacking the deck here to get higher numbers. This is within the realm of possibilities. But in 2021, we just took the mean. We took the mean of several. I can't remember how many studies measured this, but we used the mean. We did not use the highest value. And so that will lower the lactation requirements. And for a cow milking 45 kilos, the net result here is about a 4 gram increase in absorbed calcium, or excuse me, absorbed magnesium. The AC also changed a lot. In 2001, if you look it up, all the basal ingredients were given an AC of 16%. But if you read the text, it says they calculated a value of 30%, but they reduced that by one standard deviation. And again, I think they wanted to get these requirements higher, even though, like I said, we are not supposed to build in safety factors. They kind of cheated here and did that. The problem, though, I don't have a problem with what they did, but then when you calculate the absorption coefficient of supplemental magnesium, they should have used 0.3, but they used 0.16, and that means the estimated or the calculated AC for supplements was wrong. They had 70% availability for magox, 90% for mag sulfate. We got the same number, 30% available for basal feeds. We put in equations to adjust for dietary K. So everything we standardized here is to 1.2% K. When we use this to calculate the absorption coefficient of supplements, you can see magox is only 23% available, not 70. Mag sulfate is 27% available, not 90. So if the diet was 50% basal magnesium, 50% from magox, in 2001, you'd have an absorption coefficient of 43. In 2021, the absorption coefficient would only be 27%. So very significant changes to magnesium. And this just shows the relationship between K and magnesium. We took this data and other data and came up with an equation relating K to magnesium absorption. Other factors affect magnesium, but these are not included in the software. They are discussed in the text. And if you buy this book, I strongly encourage you to read the text in addition to just the software. Supplemental fatty acids reduce absorption. Monensin can have positive or negative effects on absorption. High RDP or high room ammonia can have negative effects. These are not included in the software, but you should consider them. So at the end of the day here, when we look at diet, they're twice as high. In 2001, because the absorption coefficient is lower, the requirements are higher. So twice as high. And don't forget, except for dry cows, there's data showing increased magnesium reduces the risk of hypocalcemia. We consider that a response, not a requirement. So you may want to feed more magnesium than what NRC is recommending because of potential health benefits. Again, those are not included in the requirements. Excuse me. Now, for the electrolytes, these are really hard. I'm just going to tell you, these are really hard to come up with requirements, especially using the factorial approach, because the factorial approach doesn't include any effect of electrolytes on rumen pH or metabolic pH, blood pH. That's not in here. Water balance, which can have increasing water flux, can have significant benefits in some situations. So these are a little bit difficult, and very often you should be feeding more than the requirements. I'm not going to go into great detail here, but the absorption coefficient for potassium is 100%. I showed you this data earlier. That's higher than 2001. This is the endogenous fecal. And so in 2001, you can see what they did. And you can see what we did, but at the end of the day, we changed excretion rates substantially, or excretion routes, but the requirements really didn't change. Growth increase, growth requirement, which is a very minor requirement for lactating cows, didn't change. Pregnancy and lactation requirements didn't change. So potassium requirements, very, very similar to what they were in 2001. Sodium, same basic approach, absorption coefficients 100%. That's higher than what was in 2001. This is the endogenous fecal. You'll see that in 2001, the requirement was 100% endogenous urine. In 2021, it's 100% endogenous fecal. Cows are extremely good at saving sodium in the urine. They will excrete essentially no sodium if you feed low sodium diets, but they still have to excrete sodium in feces. So biologically, this is the correct route. Feces, not urine. But again, at the end of the day, the requirements changed very little with respect to maintenance. Slight increase, very little change. What changed a lot was milk. 2001 said milk has 0.65 grams per kilogram sodium. That was based on data published in 65, so 60 years ago. When we summarized data since 2001, we came up with a sodium concentration of about 0.4, significantly lower. What we think is happening is mastitis, cows with mastitis secrete high sodium milk. Our milk quality is much, much better today than it was 60 years ago. So we think this change just reflects better milk quality. But this also reflects what cows are doing today and reflects the requirement. So big changes in equations, but essentially no change in requirements. I'm not going to go into the details. Chloride followed sodium almost exactly. No big changes. DCAD, there is a DCAD requirement. This is the DCAD equation, and that's basically if you set the minimum requirements for potassium, sodium, chloride, and sulfur, that comes up with a DCAD of 175 for a lactating cow. But we do know their cows respond to, and I'm limiting this discussion to lactating cows, cows respond to elevated DCAD. Elevated DCAD usually can buffer rumen pH. It's positively related to milk fat. So there is the requirement, and then there's the optimum. And the optimum is based in economics. Feeding more DCAD, it has been shown to increase milk and milk fat. So if milk fat's valuable and it costs has more value than increasing the DCAD, you should do it. But that's a response, not a requirement. Okay, now into traces. We had adequate data to call copper and zinc requirements. We did not have adequate data to call cobalt, iron, manganese, and selenium requirements. We called those adequate intakes. And remember, that doesn't mean you don't have to feed these, but it's just saying when we say this is the adequate intake for cobalt, you should probably feed that much, but we don't have as much confidence in that number as we do for copper and zinc. In this table here, the first line for every mineral is supplemental. So this is the range in absorption coefficients of supplemental copper in 2001, and this is in 2021. The next line for every mineral is the absorption coefficient for the basal diet. The numbers in blue were substantially changed from 2001. Copper absorption was increased substantially. You can see, well, it's only from 4 to 5%, but that's a 25% increase. Iron, no change because there's no data. Manganese dropped almost 50%. Basal was 0.75% in 2001. Now it's 0.4%. So manganese is essentially unavailable. Cows do not need very much manganese every day, and so they don't have to absorb very much every day. But significant decreases in manganese ACs. Zinc went up from 15 to 20%. And again, some of these changes reflect the way we calculated the endogenous fecal fraction. Some of them reflect better data. Okay, for the minerals that didn't change, iron, the adequate intake from 2001 didn't change. It's not, you don't need to supplement it. Selenium in the U.S. Is regulated. I don't know about other countries. So the AI adequate intake was set at 0.3 supplemental because that's what our regulations allow. But total diet then is about 0.4. So the adequate intake for selenium is 0.4, a diet with 0.4 milligrams per kilogram. And basically for lactating cows, that looks fine. I mean, there was really no, even if we could change it, there really isn't much reason to. I think the data support that number. Chromium is a required mineral or probably required, but we didn't establish a requirement because we don't know what it is. We don't know what, you know, there's got to be a lot of diets with adequate basal chromium because we don't see classic or physiological abnormality if we don't supplement chromium. Measuring basal chromium is extraordinarily difficult. You can't do it the routine way or the standard way, so we really don't know how much chromium is even in these diets. But again, this is a response. There is good data showing if you supplement chromium, you might get more milk. But again, that is not a requirement, that's a response. For iodine, it didn't change very much. For high producing cows, it would go up a little bit because we are accounting for basal iodine in milk. Cobalt went up a little bit from 0.11 to 0.2 milligrams per kilogram. This is not a milligrams per day. It's a concentration because it's a ruminal requirement. This was adjusted just because of newer data saying that this is probably closer to maintaining liver B12 values than the old value. So a small increase in cobalt. Copper was a major change, and we wanted to really evaluate copper because at least in the U.S. and I know certain areas in Europe, excess copper intake is a concern. Very high hepatic liver concentrations, toxicity issues. So we looked at this very, very closely. And what you're going to see is the first thing I'm going to say, we were concerned about excess copper, and we doubled the maintenance requirement. And again, we doubled it because that's what the data said. However, again, remember, this is all endogenous fecal. The AC was also increased. So some of this increase in maintenance is accounted for by a higher AC. However, look at this here. This is in 2001. They said milk has 0.15 milligrams copper per kilogram. That's from all the data we dug up. And there's been several studies published where they publish the concentration of copper in milk. It's only 0.04, not 0.15. We couldn't find a single number up this high. So I'm a little bit confused where this came from. But this is a huge reduction in the lactation requirement. So for an average cow, 650 kilograms, at producing 35 kilograms of milk, the overall total requirement hardly changed. Maintenance went up, lactation went down, no net effect. So they had the average cow about right. They got there the wrong way, but they got it right. But a dry cow, because most of her requirement is maintenance, it went up 40%, very significant increase. But a high producing cow, because of this huge reduction in lactation, it dropped 45%. So theoretically, a diet with 10 parts per million copper could meet the copper requirement of these high-producing cows. I'd still build a little buffer in, but they don't need a high concentration. So again, overall, the high copper is a concern, and high liver copper is a concern, but it wasn't because 2001 overestimated requirements. Again, they got there the wrong way, but they had the average requirements, I think, pretty close to right. Manganese. This was looked at very carefully. This is an adequate intake, not a requirement because very limited data. There was direct studies with beef animals using NRC concentration. What NRC 2001 said should be adequate manganese was fed to beef heifers. It was shown to, if you did that, the calves born from those heifers were clinically deficient in manganese. They had abnormal jaw development or facial bone development. Clinical deficiency, not marginal, but clinical. We found some studies, or a study, I should say, where we could estimate maintenance. That was increased about 30% over 2001. This paper was published after 2001, so it wasn't available to them then. We dug up some new data on absorption coefficient for manganese, and I say this is new, but it's still data done, experiments done, I think, almost 40 years ago. It's much easier to search scientific literature now than it was in 2000. So we could find papers that they were unable to find in 2001. So it's more data, but it's clearly not new data or newly generated data. So when you put all this together, dry cow requirement went up more than doubled. Lactating cow more than doubled. So very significant increases in manganese. On zinc, maintenance was now a function of dry matter intake. In 2001, it was a function of body weight. So again, if the cows eat a lot, maintenance will change more than if for cows that didn't eat much. The AC changed, again, largely because we changed metabolic fecal zinc. So when we look at a dry cow here, overall, on average, the requirement increased about 10%. That's going to be up around 30 parts per million for a typical dry cow. A high producing cow, and I think this was a 40 or 45 kilogram milk cow, increased about 15%. So it's going to be up around 60. And again, remember, this is for 50% of the population. And you probably want to feed for more than 50% of the population. So you'll want to add safety factors. On vitamins, very quickly here, these are all adequate intakes. These are not requirements because we do not have very much data. For most of these studies, the typical experiment will have an unsupplemented control and then one level. That's the typical experiment. I understand why we do that. It takes a lot of cows. We don't, and a lot of money, and we just can't have multiple levels. There was no established AIs for water-soluble vitamins. The text has a very, very extensive review on this subject, and we talk about responses. Choline often increases milk production. That's discussed. Biotin often increases milk production, so it's discussed. So the economic or the production responses are discussed, but these are not requirements, so we do not give an adequate intake for any water-soluble vitamin. D, I do know the alphabet, but I'm going to start with D because A and E are related. For vitamin D, well, actually for all the fat-soluble vitamins, the AI is supplemental, not total. And it's done that way. One is most people do not measure vitamins in feeds, and for vitamin D you have a greater another complication is how much vitamin D is going to be synthesized from the sun. We do not adjust for cows inside or outside. Again, the text has significant discussion on what you might want to do if cows are outside. Most of the data that we use for vitamin D are for cows housed mostly inside with very limited direct sun excess or sun exposure. The requirements are based largely on vitamin D3. There's significant data saying D2 is worth only 50% of D3. And in the human U.S. human system, D2 is given 50% of the value of D3. We did not do that. We gave the same IU efficiency for D2 and D3. Because we lacked adequate data, but I think it's very clear D2 is worth substantially less than D3. So the numbers assume D3 are fed. 2001 vitamin D requirement was based almost exclusively on calcium metabolism, because that's pretty much what we thought vitamin D did. There's been a huge amount of data, not so much in cows, but a huge amount of data with vitamin D on lots of species. It has tremendous effects outside of calcium. It affects immunity, it affects gene expression, it affects lots of things. So what we set the requirement on was not to maintain adequate blood calcium, but was to maintain blood 25-hydroxy vitamin D at greater than 30 nanograms per mil. This was selected based on limited data. I'll freely admit that, but it was saying that in general, health outcomes are better if blood vitamin D, 25 vitamin D is greater than this. So that was our response measurement. Dry cows was maintained. This is the same requirement as in 2001, but based on a study, a survey basically showing that you needed to feed more than 30 IUs per day to ensure all cows had more than 30 nanograms per mil. So we selected 40 IUs per kilogram body weight for vitamin D3, and that should essentially, every cow fed that should have blood vitamin D greater than 30. So increase in lactating cows for vitamin D. Vitamin A, again, it's supplemental. We know pasture is a good source of beta carotene, which then can be converted to retinol. This was not adjusted for, because one is that this conversion efficiency of beta carotene to vitamin A is being questioned a lot right now. The number we use, which I can't even remember, I think it's 400 IUs per milligram of beta carotene, but don't quote me on that. That is extremely old, decades old. Data with humans clearly shows that the conversion efficiency is substantially less than what they thought. Beta carotene, it does provide retinol, but not nearly as much as we thought, at least for humans. So we didn't make an adjustment here because we didn't have confidence in what the conversion efficiency was. No change for dry cows, heifers, and lactating cows producing less than 35 kilograms of milk. So this is the same from 2001. However, retinol has about 1,000 IUs of, milk has about 1,000 IUs of retinol per kilogram. The average production from all these studies we used in 2001 was less than 35 kilograms. So we said, well, on these higher producing cows, we have to adjust for the retinol that goes out in milk. Milk has 1,000 IUs of vitamin A per kilogram. So basically for every kilogram of milk above 35 per day, we tack on another 1,000 units. And this is, again, just to cover the milk, the retinol secreted in milk. The AI for pre-fresh remained the same as dry cows, and I'll discuss that just in a moment. For vitamin E, again, it's supplemental, but in this case, we could adjust for grazing. We have a pretty good idea of the average vitamin E concentration or tocopherol concentration in pasture relative to silage and hay, so we make that adjustment. If they're grazing, you put down how many kilos of fresh pasture you think they're eating. We adjust the amount of supplemental needed. And then in some cases, it will go to zero. We increased at least the requirement. This is regulated in the U.S. on the feed tag. So feed tags will not show this. But there's good data that says RRR tocopherol, this is natural tocopherol, is better than the old standard conversion compared to the all racemic tocopherol acetate. This is the common supplemental kind. So if you're feeding RRR, you should use the coefficients shown in the book. Again, the coefficients, at least in the U.S., on the feed tag will reflect the old or the standard conversion. Dry cows, no change, about 1,000 units a day. Lactating cows and heifers, no change at about 500. This is about going to be 500 per day. But we did increase the AI for pre-fresh cows. And this is 2 or 3 weeks. And this is, you need to do 2 or 3 weeks because the data showing longer term supplementation of high vitamin E might be detrimental. So this is clearly just a pre-fresh, not the whole dry period. And we bumped that up 1,000 units. This data is mainly, or this reason was mastitis, early lactation mastitis, early lactation metritis, and retained placenta was the reason for that. The reason, this is plasma retinol and tocopherol. We're going to skip beta carotene. This is cows that where the mammary gland was removed prior to calving. This is intact cows. And for retinol, you see this huge decrease in plasma retinol. And so you're saying, well, why don't you recommend feeding elevated retinol to help avoid this? Whereas with vitamin E does the same thing. And we did recommend high vitamin E during this pre-fresh cow period. And again, partly because of this great decrease in plasma vitamin E. But there's no data showing that feeding, or there's data with elevated vitamin A in the pre-fresh, but it doesn't tend to change this drop. So this is why we recommend more for pre-fresh vitamin E and no change for pre-fresh vitamin A. It's just, again, data is not available showing increasing A during this period has a positive response. So to summarize, I want to first say heifer data is very, very limited. In most cases, it's an extrapolation from lactating cows or from cows. So very, very limited. You can see for most of these macro minerals, other than magnesium, nothing changed much. Slight increases in calcium, but the rest of them didn't change, but significant, substantial increases in magnesium absorption. For the traces and vitamins, cobalt went up a bit. Copper went up a lot for a dry cow. It stayed the same for an average cow. It decreased significantly for a high producing cow. No change in iron. Manganese went up a lot for all classes. Selenium, no change. Slightly increased zinc requirements for dry and lactating cows. Vitamin A, essentially no change except for high producing cows. Vitamin D, no change except for lactating cows in general. And vitamin E, no change except elevating or establishing a pre-fresh requirement. And with that, I thank you for your attention and I'll turn it back to the moderator.
Okay, so we have a few questions come in from the audience. So thanks everybody for submitting those. I'll start at the top. So first of all, can you explain why it is more accurate to calculate the maintenance requirement on the basis of dry matter intake rather than body weight?
Okay. Well, again, remember maintenance for minerals is mostly endogenous fecal losses. And when you think of what these losses are, they're slough cells, they're secretions. And that should be a function of how much feed is flowing through the digestive tract, not how big a cow is. And just think, you can have a dry cow weigh 700 kilograms, you can have a lactating cow 700 kilograms. Lactating cow is eating 25 or 30 kilograms, the dry cow is 12. The cell slough, the secretions are going to be much, much higher in that high intake cow. So it just biologically, where these losses come from, they should be much more a function of intake rather than body weight.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Thank you very much. Good. I see quite a few here now. Okay, so on to the next one. What effect would heat stress have on these sodium potassium requirements? Just curious to know if it would be 2 or even 10 times of normal requirements. I know it's a difficult concept to put into figures, but would like to know some kind of ballpark guess.
Okay. Well, we looked at that, and if you remember the old one, there was an increase in sodium and K with elevated temperature, and we looked at that very, very closely. And one of the losses are sweat, and people have actually measured how much cows sweat, and they measured the composition of sweat, not a lot of people, so very limited data. And sweat losses for sodium and K based on this limited data are minimal. They're very, very small. So that starts saying where does these improvements in responses, I'm not going to say a requirement, but improvements in handling heat stress come from. One thing electrolytes do is they make cows urinate. And if they urinate a lot, they have to drink a lot. And so one way, you know, elevating K and you know, a typical K diet meet the requirements 1.1%, elevating it to 2 or 2.2%, so basically doubling it, has a very significant increase in water intake. And you got to think a cow is going to drink water. I'm used to Fahrenheit here, so I'm kind of guessing at Celsius, but the water might be 15 degrees. she's drinking even in the summer, and then 15 or 20 degrees, and urine's going to be about 40 degrees. And so that heat, so the cow heats up that water, and then that heat leaves the cow. And I did some calculations, and it's about 1 or 2% of the total heat load of a cow from increasing these electrolytes. So, and then the buffering of the rumen and other things, which aren't in there. So I would not, under heat stress conditions, would not hesitate to double K, increase sodium some. It's very hard to quantify a requirement caused by heat stress. So it's much more, I consider it a response.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Right. Okay. Another nice long one here. So you mentioned there are no new data for manganese. If I'm not mistaken, a lot of digestibility studies have been done at Ohio University. So was manganese never looked at in all those studies? To at least confirm that apparent absorption measured in those studies is consistent with the model assumption, AC, endogenous feces, net requirement. For example, apparent absorption was reported to be between 10 and 17% in Faulkner and Weiss study. This seems to be really much higher than true absorption. So is this data consistent with the new assumption?
Again, apparent and absorbed or truly absorbed is very, very different. And that apparent absorption coefficient you're quoting is just from a bunch of studies at least one of the studies was designed to study manganese. The rest were just studies, and we looked at manganese intake and fecal manganese, and that's where he came up with that number. Manganese is even more difficult than a lot of other minerals because the cow can absorb manganese, and then very often it's almost immediately dumped back into the bile. So it's absorbed, goes to the liver, and then gets dumped right out in the bile back into feces. So some of that's absorbed, obviously it's absorbed. So this is a case where this apparent absorption is always going to be significantly more than true absorption, always. So I think this is a case where there's a very large endogenous fecal fraction, which then inflates, that's the reason that the true absorption is so much less than the apparent. And that study you're talking about was used to come up with the maintenance requirement, but we did not use it for the absorption coefficient because, again, it's missing a huge amount of fecal manganese, absorbed fecal manganese.
Excellent. Okay, thanks very much. So we'll go for one more now, another long one. So which of these minerals are the most dangerous in terms of requirement value versus optimal response shown? For example, if I would formulate to the high producing cow, basic requirement will not be enough. Can you formulate NRC requirement times 2 for all minerals to get optimal response, or would you reach toxic doses on any of these minerals? Which of these minerals would you reach an LD50 the quickest when multiplying the NRC requirement by 2 or 4 for response reasons, ignoring the cost implications, of course? Okay.
Well, first, to me, there's not a single mineral with potential electrolytes where it ever two times, not one situation. Typically, you should probably feed 1.2 times, not 2 times. So 2x is too much for everything, and 4x again is not even in the realm. The most toxic mineral I think we feed is copper, relative to requirement. You can argue on a mass basis selenium is more toxic, but there are studies where, and at least for the short term, and this would be weeks or maybe a month or two, where selenium at 10 times requirement did not cause any issues. Long term on copper, values of 2, theoretically values of 2, probably 3x requirement could cause problems. So copper, I would never feed copper at 2x. Even with a lot of antagonists, sulfur and molybdenum and so on and so forth, you might have to go 50 or 60%, 1.5, 1.6 times requirement to cover antagonism. But copper is, to me, is the one we have to watch the closest, and 2x copper is some risk for toxicity. 3x, I think, is a substantial risk for long-term toxicity.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Okay, I think we'll conclude the questions now. Please don't worry. If there is more questions that we didn't answer, I can see there's lots coming in now. We will try and channel these through and get some answers for you.